Welcome to Championship Wrestling from Florida. I'm Buddy Colt, your host. Now, there's been a lot of excitement throughout the wrestling world this past week with the National Wrestling Alliance. Just to recap a few things that have happened. Just a week ago, Brian Blair defeated Rick Rude right here on television with a nationwide audience. And right now, Brian Blair is hot on the heels of Rick Rude to try and capture the coveted Southern Heavyweight Championship. Also, Chief Wahoo McDaniel, the man that has spent 10 years with the National Football League, a middle linebacker of the Miami Dolphins, and one of the greatest football players ever, since becoming a professional wrestler, has become one of the greatest wrestlers ever. Chief Wahoo McDaniel is hot after Ric Flair for the world title, and I, for one, believe that he's going to be the man to defeat him. Also, Jesse Barr and Ric Flair seem to have a very close friendship going. We're going to have to keep an eye on these two men. Now, with me today as a special guest commentator is none other than a good friend of mine who has coached the Sarasota team to a national championship in both football and wrestling, Coach John Heath.
Thank you, buddy. Listen, there's fantastic news throughout the state of Florida, but perhaps the biggest news to come to Florida in a long time will be for the fans in the Fort Lauderdale area. On Wednesday, April the 10th, at Lockhart Stadium, there will be a steel cage match between Mike Graham and Michael Hayes, with the stipulation that the loser leave Florida. Will this be the first time that the Freebirds have been split up? We'll find out. That's an interesting tie-up down there. Also, in Groveland High School, wrestling is coming to your area on Thursday, April the 4th, and none other than Chief Wahoo McDaniels will be headlining the card. And tonight, in Sebring, going back to see my old friend Coach Jim Tavernier there, plenty of matches in store at Sebring High School tonight at 8 o'clock. And among the stars appearing there will be the Young Bloods, the Missing Link, and don't forget the Young Bloods of the United States Tag Team title in their possession. They'll be defending it there tonight. Brian Blair, Ravishing Rick Rude, your Southern Heavyweight Champion, and Mr. B, Brian Blair, Mr. B, Brian Blair will be there, and as well as Bulldog Barr. A big night of wrestling in Sebring tonight, ladies and gentlemen. And, well, buddy, what an honor. We have none other than the number one man himself, the world heavyweight wrestling champion, none other than Mr. Ric Flair.
Coach, it's always a pleasure. Wow. Mr. Colt, you know, it's no secret to anybody in professional wrestling that when Ric Flair comes to the state of Florida, he not only beats all the top competition day in and day out, he drives the women wild. Because the people, especially the women in Florida, are starved for the sight of a real man and a real champion. Let's face it, the Dolphins don't get it done, the Bucks don't get it done. So when they get a championship caliber athlete in this state, they really know how to treat him, isn't that right, sweetheart?
Yeah.
Who is the greatest athlete alive today? Well, thank you very much, darling. That didn't take much. Ric Flair is what's happening today. Now, I've got to tell you, Coach Heath, I was enraged when they told me that Wahoo McDaniels came down here, got with the National Wrestling Alliance, got with the Board of Governors right here from CWF, and bought all my contracts. Wahoo, you're a great athlete. You're a tremendous champion in your own right, but you're a long ways away from being Ric Flair. And Mike Graham, very sorry to hear about your family problems, but brother, as I told you, and I told everybody in professional wrestling, you're at the bottom of the list right now, Mike Graham. You might have promised everybody in the world heavyweight championship on a platter, but right now, kid, you've got a long way to go, baby. You're looking at the world heavyweight champion, custom made from head to toe. You're looking finer than any athlete alive. Coach Heath, you know I was a great amateur wrestler, is that right?
I certainly will approve of
it. Look at this fool. What are you doing out here on my time? Look at this fool. Who's this guy here, honey?
We have big deal.
You know big deal. Get out of here,
kid. Let me tell you something. With all respect to your lady, a lady won't make you tough. And your big mouth isn't going to give you ability. And let me tell you something else, Blair. Money doesn't make a man. If money made a man, you'd be wearing a dress like your lady. You say you won't wrestle me. What makes a man is ability in that ring. Ability in the ring. So
I understand that you're a big deal in the state of Florida. I understand you got all the money, but I got a Rolex watch too, my Graham. And I don't care how badly you try to insult me. They know that I'm the man that makes professional what it is today. You want to match with me? Huh? You want to wrestle me sometime? You want to go to Miami, Fort Lauderdale, Tampa? Sign a contract. I'll wrestle you anywhere you want to wrestle me.
Did you gentlemen get there what he said?
He'll
wrestle me anywhere?
Anywhere. Sign the contract.
That's what he said.
How about right here in 10 minutes?
Rick, you were just offered a challenge.
I'll see you right there in 10 minutes.
Hey, fool, come on back here. What do you mean 10 minutes? I'm out here dressed up showing these people what a man looks like. I'm not wrestling on TV here today.
Well,
let me
Rick,
tell you something, you Mr. Colt, if this idiot wants to get on television with me and try and show the whole wrestling world that he's a championship caliber athlete, you were a great amateur wrestler, and you appreciate amateur wrestling. Coach, for you, I'll beat Mike Graham, amateur wrestling. I'll let him up, and then I'll pin him professional style in 10 minutes.
Well, buddy, that sounds like we're going to see some action later on in this program.
Quite interesting. We're going to see Ric Flair, the world champion, later on today, going up against Mike Graham. And I think Mike Graham has an excellent chance of defeating him. We'll be right back after this.
Gentlemen, this match, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing the team to my left from Albany, Georgia, weighing in at 231 pounds, here's Dale Veazey, and his partner from St. Petersburg, weighing in at 228 pounds, the man with a perfect record, Jack Hart. And their opponents from New Mexico, weighing in with a combined weight of 484 pounds, Mark and Jay Youngblood, the Youngbloods. One fall.
Okay, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Mark and Jay Youngblood, of course, being the Southern Heavyweight Wrestling Champions. Now, Jack Hart here has had more or less a long, hard game to try and win himself the first match. So far, he is about 0-47. He has himself quite a part. Coach, what do you think Jack Hart's chances are today?
Well, I've been following Jack a little closer than you, buddy. In fact, Jack broke the National Wrestling Alliance record that was set in 1912 by canvasback Bull Mulligan when he lost his 51st consecutive match. Bull Mulligan retired after losing 50 straight, and right now Jack is 0-56.
Well, he has quite a record going. Very nice drop toe hold on the part of Mark Youngblood there. And down went Jack Deasy. Jack Deasy, of course, having a lot of respect. Well, you see Percival Pringle there looking a little concerned right now. Percival Pringle does have Jack Hart under his wing. However, Dale Deasy is not one of his men at the time. Very nice shoulder block. Looks like Dale Deasy doing some fast thinking, but not fast enough. Nice arm drag takedown. And there's Mark Youngblood coming up with a nice arm bar.
We have a strong spin on there executed by Mark there with an outside bar lock. And he has Beasley under control. Dale picks him up for a full slam. As Dale Beasley, a very powerfully built individual. However, when Jack came in, he was caught off balance by Mark. And with the spin under affected by Mark, taken to the mat. Now both Mark and Jay in the ring on a double chop. I guess Jack wishes he was back in his corner once again.
Well, you know, Coach, I was really thinking that since Jack Hart has been under the direction of Percival Pringle, that he might be doing a little bit better. So far, he hasn't done too well this match. He's going to have to change his strategy.
Well, we do see some improvements in spasmodic shots. Well, a deep tap stuck in there by Jay and took him over into the play. And Jack is having a tough time today. Although he is speaking with Percival Pringle, he says he does see improvement in Jack, and potentially he has a winner in him. Although I hope that Percy's blood pressure can stay up until the day he does get a winner, because Percy is more excited about things, I think, than Jack Hart is.
Well, Jack Hart just made a tag to Dale Beasy coming in for a little brief double-teaming there. Dale Beasy having Mr. Young, a nice high flying drop kick. Dale Beasy can move. This guy is quite an athlete. Coming on there with his big hard boots right to the head of Mark Youngblood.
He stuck a deep pass in, took him over into an inside cradle, but the strength and size of Youngblood broke him out of that Barely put in combination in the match. Let's see Jack up on the second rope there and applying the foot to Mark Gunblood, but he receives a tremendous chop in return. And now Jack whips Mark off. Mark takes him over into a double crucifix combination, but Jack, through the use of his legs, is able to take it out. And Jack has now applied a strong side headlock on to Jack.
Well, Percy Pringle looking quite concerned there at ringside momentarily, but Jack Hart right now has the match under control. He has a very good side headlock secured quite nicely. Well, it's like Mark Youngblood is trying to force Jack over to the corner so he can make a tag. Percy Pringle, you see there, motioning to Jack to get his man back. Get back over towards your own corner, Jack. Looks like Jack is still hanging on there to that side headlock. Oh, nice back to play there on the part of Mark Youngblood. That slows down Jack. Time for both of these men to tag out and get the first man in. Jack was able to tag out to Dale Beasley, and in comes Dale.
And I see that Mark has applied side headlock, and now a series of chops to the head of Dale Beasley. Jack Hart must have had a very strong headlock on Mark Youngblood, because I saw it to play that Mark is very slow coming up, buddy.
Yeah, well, right here you see a little double teaming. The referee can't see everything. You know, with four people in there, it's hard for the referee to see everything, so you can't really blame the ref on these types of things. Oh, big hard right to the pit of the stomach, and another left, a hard left. Like Mark Youngblood, a lot of trouble. That big, powerful elbow upside the upper chest. This could be it.
Yeah. Long push off by Youngblood saved the day for him. And we have a front face lock being applied by Dale Beasley. He has dug out to Jack Hart. Jack comes in a forearm across the back of Mark. He tried for a double lasso. And they received a double drop kick instead. And both men were down by the very athletic Mark Youngblood. And Jerry Youngblood coming in and wreaking some havoc on the man. And he has got Dale Beasley in a lot of trouble. And Mark Youngblood has taken Jack Hart out of the picture. Short shoulder smash to put Dale Beasley out onto the side. And now Jack Hart starting to get back into the ring.
It looks like all men are a little bit worn out here. Well, Jack Hart, the first one in, going in for an inside cradle. Referee going down. Three count, and Jack Hart lost the hurry. And the victors are Mark and Jay Youngblood. Okay, and we'll be right back after this.
I'll tell you what, he wasn't even the legal man in the ring. How can the referee? I want to copy this tape, Coach. I want it in my office, in the morning. We're going to do something better. You're going to help me out. I'm the kind of guy that likes to go everywhere and do everything. You know what I mean? Because I don't sidestep no opponent. I don't back down from nobody. I like to live hard. I like to love hard. But in order to live hard and love hard, a good-looking guy like myself has to have a good-looking, or even more than a good-looking girl, a good-looking guy like myself has to have that perfect 10. Just to fit in just right with my own style, you know what I mean? Now, I went out with a lot of good-looking gals here in Florida. Don't get me wrong, there are a few good-looking gals left here in the South. But to find that 10, I had to go all the way back west. I had to go back to sunny Southern California. And, Coach, next week right here, I'm going to have a big surprise for you and all these poor old deprived boys down here in the South. How about it, bro?
And I'll tell you what, she's great, Coach. If she excites me, I'm telling what to do the rest of the man. Right? She's going to take care of my Ricky.
Thank you.
She excites me.
Okay. We have a match coming up in the ring. Let's go to Jay Goodley, the ring announcer.
This match is one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing to my right from Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, weighing in at 241 pounds, here's Mike Golden. And his opponent to my left from Beverly Hills, California, accompanied by Percival Pringle III, the Southern Heavyweight Champion. Here he is, the Ravishing One, Ravishing Rick Rude. One fall.
Yeah.
Okay, Ravishing Rick Rude going up against Mike Golden. Ravishing Rick says he has a big surprise for us next week, talking about some beautiful woman that he has that's going to be here that he calls the perfect 10. But Rick Rude, of course, being the Southern Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, and he has been taking on a lot of tough contenders this past few weeks. So we have to give this man credit. Quite an impressive body and development of the man. He spends a lot of time in the gym, going up against Mike Golden. Mike Golden being quite an athlete himself.
Well, we have two very strong competitors here and two well-built athletes in the ring at the present time. Side headlock presented on there by Mike Golden. Thrown off by Rick Rude and overstepped and outsmarted momentarily by Mike Golden, who applied the side headlock through the hip end, through the hip over, and now has the Southern Heavyweight Champion, Ravishing Rick Rude, imprisoned and in a predicament on the mat. And if you could trap that left arm, bring it up, you'd have him in a, what we call, side chancing lock and could possibly put him in a semi combination, buddy.
Well, it looks like right here, Rick Rude is going into a little bit of a test of the strength with Mike Golden. This could be very close. Rick Rude able to get up there, and he got the leverage, and he got him down, and up comes Rick Rude with an arm bar. So you see the strength in the arms of Rick Rude here.
To challenge the arms of a man who was inside the National Arm Wrestling Champion, it's not the move that I would predicate upon by wrestlers, I'll tell you. That's his strongest point. However, I did see Mike Golden come back with a nice side headlock through the hip end, took him over, and again, he has him in prison. And I think if Mike was smart, he would stay away from challenging the arm strength of one powerful Ravishing Rick Rude.
That's right. There are many other ways that you can gain control of your opponent without going into the test of strength. Right there, you see Mike Golden has that side headlock, but once again, the strong arms of Rick Rude were able to throw him off, making some nice moves here. And a big body block, and down goes Ravishing Rick. Mike Golden coming right back up with a side headlock takedown, and you notice how Mike Golden has his body weight across the upper torso of Rick Rude, which forces Rick Rude to breathe a little bit harder, using up some of the valuable energy.
Well, he's got a nice thing going for him right now with his headlock series. I think he ought to stay right in that range. If anything else were to become available to him, I'd go into the leg area. But once again, as I said before, stay away from the arms. A nice, strong back to play, showing the powerful neck. And again, I say the spinae rectus muscles are the back of Ravishing Rick. A deep half run, high vertical to play by Ravishing Rick. And Golden finds himself in an awful lot of trouble. But with the youth and the strength that he possesses, he was able to press Rick off. And Rick goes about 230 pounds. And he's inflicting an awful lot of damage in the lower back area. And now the cover once again by Rick. Now, Rick is going to have to captivate one of those legs to put a half moon reverse Nelson up there on Golden. He's not going to be able to hold him down just by a body press.
Well, Rick has had several pinning combinations on Mike Golden here. So far, Mike Golden has been able to power out. But Rick Rude staying right on top of him, a big right to the midsection from Mike Golden. Another right, but not having much effect. The stomach muscles of Rick Rude are just powerful. You see the ripples in his stomach. It's going to take a lot to hurt him by hitting him in the stomach. He has had Mike Golden in constant trouble for several minutes now. Up. There's where Mike Golden was able to outsmart Rick Rude, and the tide has turned. But once again, Rick Rude saw what was happening, and he raked the eyes of Mike Golden, slowed him down.
Well, Rick lost by Rick Rude. However, when Golden came off, he applied a boot right to the midsection of the Southern Heavyweight Champion. Arm dragged him into the ropes, came off, gave him an elbow, and I'll tell you, the Southern Heavyweight Champion is in trouble. Clothesline, lasso, lariat, whatever you want to call it. Light body press to try to go for that far leg pickup. Was unable to close it up, and again we have Rude on his feet, being whipped into the rope by Golden, and he applied an elbow deep into the neck area, and a deep half and a straight drop, and I think that'll do it, buddy.
That's it. Another victory for Ravishing Rick Rude, the Southern Heavyweight Champion. Percy Pringle going in to congratulate him, and we'll be right back after this. Okay. Okay, we have a match coming up in the ring very shortly, but I'd like to remind everybody that we do have later in the program today, the World's Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, Ric Flair, will be having a match right here on TV against Mike Graham. This is going to be quite an exciting match. Coach, very seldom do you see the world champion on television.
Well, Mike Graham got to him today. He got under his chin, and it may cost Ric Flair an awful lot. He thinks he's a fool. Mike got to him. Mike wanted to get to him. And if anybody can take Ric Flair, Mike Graham is the man. Not judging just because I had him for 36 years, but he is one of the greatest wrestlers in the world today.
Well, Mike really has proven himself throughout the wrestling world, and I, for one, will be pulling for Mike Graham. So let's go to the ring. We have an exciting ring coming up now, and that's coming up in the ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, this match is one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing in the corner to my left from Minnesota at 264 pounds, here's Wild Bill Irwin and Percival Pringle III presents The Missing Link. And their opponents, from Mexico City, Mexico, weighing in at 228 pounds, here's Hector Guerrero. And from Brandon, Florida, at 275 pounds, his partner, Bugsy McGraw. One fall with a 10-minute time limit.
Looks like the participants here did not want to wait for the bell. This is going to be quite a match here with 4 minutes in the ring like this. There's Bugsy McGraw holding up Hector Guerrero, and down goes the Missing Link. Down goes this pandemonium. Percival Pringle has come out to the ring here. Percival Pringle is screaming and hollering for instructions, wanting his men to get out of the ring. They are on the losing end of everything here. Like a Missing Link there. He's going back in with a bar stool. And Bugsy McGraw has the chair. Out goes the Missing Link. Percival Pringle wanting his men to get out of the ring. Things are going against Percy Pringle's dynasty. Things are not working too well. The Missing Link is going berserk here. Now he's got these chairs. Looks like he's trying to throw the whole stairs inside. Well, it looks like things might finally be settling down just a little bit. Wild Bill Irwin going into the ring. The referee trying to get that stool out of the ring. But Bugsy McGraw and Hector Guerrero are standing there ready for anything that the team of Percival Pringle might have to offer.
Well, things will settle down. They'll come down from a hurricane to a tornado. With a combination of the four athletes you have in the ring at the present time, the size and the power of Bugsy McGraw, the speed and the wrestling ability of Hector Guerrero, the unbelievable strength and physique of the Missing Link, the brains of Percival Pringle III, and the raw, sheer size and power of Wild Bill Irwin. What a combination of wrestlers, and a lot of punishment being dealt out, mainly by the team of Bugsy McGraw and Hector Guerrero.
Well, I'll tell you, it seems like Hector Guerrero and Bugsy McGraw together. Sounds like they have the power and speed and ingenuity, everything going for them. Looks like the Missing Link, he can't really believe what's happening. It's so very seldom the Missing Link has things going against him. This is something new for the Link. First of all, Pringle is going crazy here on the floor, just running around giving instructions to Wild Bill Irwin. Nothing going right for Percival Pringle today. Bugsy McGraw just standing there waiting, just challenging the Missing Link. This here, these two men, both big, strong, and powerful. The Missing Link coming back over, looking at Percy Pringle for instructions.
Well, Percival Pringle III's main item of power to his teams, of course, is the psyching of another team or another individual. However, how are you going to psych a Bugsy McGraw? Usually it just works the opposite. Bugsy McGraw is just about as far out as you can get. And you're not gonna attach Bugsy McGraw to any psychological disadvantages whatsoever. And I see that the Link, who has been frustrated very much in this match so far, starting to unleash some type of an attack. However, I see that Hector Guerrero has tied up the Link. Bugsy McGraw and Hector both have the Link into the corner. And Hector Guerrero applying forearms into the chest and neck area of the Link. Wow. Hector was trying to set himself up for a backdrop against the link. However, he was caught by a boot into the midsection from the link. That's the size, about a 15 or 16, I guess, buddy.
Well, Hector Guerrero, very smartly taken out, too, as part of Bugs McGraw. Bugs McGraw coming in with a big hammer-like right into the side of the head of the missing link. Goes the link. It takes a lot to knock the link down. But the, look at that. I thought that it looked like Percival Pringle right into the back of Bucky McGraw with that big umbrella there.
The referee has called for disqualification, I believe. And rightly so.
Bucky McGraw after Percival Pringle. Percival Pringle's going to have to get out of the way very quickly. Percival Pringle hiding behind the missing link. It's time for, it looks like Percival Pringle had best get out of that ring. And a quick bailout he does. Hector Guerrero putting the finishing touches on Wild Bill Irwin. Percival Pringle very upset with his men today. Okay, and we'll be right back after this. And remember, Ric Flair and Mike Graham.
Early in the program, there was a challenge issued by Ric Flair when he became upset against Mike Graham, and this challenge has been accepted. And, buddy, this is what they're all waiting for.
That's right. This is going to be one of the best matches you'll ever going to see on wrestling here on TV. Right now, it seemed like when Ric Flair made the challenge, he didn't anticipate Mike Graham coming back with a stipulation to be right here on television, because it would really be embarrassing to Ric Flair if he was to lose right here on Nationwide TV. Okay, let's go to the ring with Jay Goodley. Mike Graham's in the ring waiting for Ric Flair.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a special challenge match. I don't normally make a habit of wrestling on national televised programs unless there's a lot of money involved. But because Michael Graham has come out here and attempted to insult me, which means he's insulted the National Wrestling Alliance, I'm going to make an exception today, and I'm going to show both of you, I'm sure you're well aware of the fact, but I'm going to show you once again why I'm considered the greatest wrestler and the greatest heavyweight champion of all time.
Well, we have to agree that this man is the world heavyweight wrestling champion. That speaks for itself. Once again, let's go to the ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is a special challenge match, one fall with a 20-minute time limit. Introducing from Tampa, Florida, weighing in at 225 pounds, here's Mike Graham. And his opponent from Charlotte, North Carolina, weighing in at 242 pounds, the heavyweight wrestling champion of the world, Nature Boy Ric Flair. One fall with a 20-minute time limit.
Okay, here we go. Mike Graham squaring off, getting ready to go up against Ric Flair. Ric Flair spending many thousands of dollars on these resplendent robes that he wears into the ring. This man is one of the most ostentatious men that I have ever seen. Everything is flashy and flamboyant. But the man is, of course, a great wrestler. Just being World Heavyweight Champion speaks for itself. See, right here, if Mike Graham can gain a victory over Ric Flair, this would be embarrassing to Ric Flair because it is on Nationwide TV. Nice drop toe hold. It's a good spin out by Mike Graham, and escaping very easily, very swiftly.
Well, both men, you know, are great applicators of the figure four leg lock, and a nice near late scissor drop by Ric Flair. Reversal and switch by Mike Graham, who has a high, loose ride, frustrating the world champion at the present time. And Mike Graham's amateur high school and collegiate background is not to be doubted. He's one of the finest collegiate wrestlers of all time ever produced in this country. And he's going up against the number one professional, possibly of all time, produced in this country, in Ric Flair. So both men adept at applying the figure four leg lock. And Mike Graham's forte also, a three-quarter Nelson from the long side or the right side. Ric Flair's other strong forte in the hole, so it has the strong application of a headlock with a forearm tie-up, putting you into a pinning combination. That there by the world champion Ric Flair, and he's got him tied up in a rear chin lock, buddy.
for this reverse chin lock. It's not a submission hold. This is a hold that is designed to just wear down your opponent, slow down your breathing, make you breathe harder, strain harder. Mike Brand trying to set out and escape. Ric Flair riding right on Sting, right on top. Ric Flair still having Mike into the ropes, which of course calls for an automatic break. It's like Mike Brand can retaliate in the same way that Ric Flair can when the referee calls for a break. Both men really having a lot of respect for one another. Mike Brand standing there ready and poised, just waiting, keeping his eye on Ric Flair at all times.
A nice series of hip rolls by Mike to shake him from there. I thought he might apply a Grandy roll onto the world champion. And another drop leg scissors to the near side by Ric Flair, only to be reversed by a spin out to the left side by Mike Graham, who now has the left arm of the world champion, Ric Flair, imprisoned. And in comes the Sullivan bar and reverse Nelson. Once he gets that reverse Nelson locked in there, Bud, Hammerlock, of course, becomes known as the Sullivan bar. And he wants to get the reverse pass in a little bit deeper, a little more body weight on there, Mike. Get off those knees and put the weight up into the chest there. But powerful, and he is 245 pounds. World champion was able to come out.
Okay, big, nice shoulder block on the part of Mike Graham. Down goes Ric Flair. Mike Graham coming up with the arm bar on Ric Flair's left arm, just putting that muscle on there. Nice fireman's carry, hanging on to that arm. Ric Flair could be in a little bit of trouble. A little bit early in the match to see. These men right now are trying to wear out each other. Mike Graham just hanging on to that arm bar.
Well, he's just upon an inside arm bar now to a stretch. And twist. And Flair about to whip Mike off into the rope. Mike comes back with a strong shoulder smash against the champion. And a miss of the forearm. Applying lateral thrust. And he has the champion down for the two count. A narrow predicament escaped by the world champion.
Like the world champion backstabbing, going back into the corner. Wanting to slow things down just a little bit. If we do have to cut away for a commercial break here, if anything happens during that time, we will show it back to you in its entirety. Right now it looks like Mike Graham wanting Ric Flair to come out of the corner. Circling very slowly. These men have a tremendous amount of respect for another. So much riding on this. Ric Flair has so much to lose if he is defeated on Nationwide TV. Now it looks like Ric Flair is using his fist. Mike Graham's in a lot of trouble. That big boot right in the pit of the stomach. That knocks all the air out of you. Forces you to really suck for breath. Breathe hard.
Well, the endurance and strength of Ric Flair cannot be doubted one iota. After all, he is on the road all over the world, 6-7 nights a week, wrestling the very finest competition in each and every state or country that he goes into. And here we see some of the power that has maintained this man to be 3 times world heavyweight wrestling champion. Has the top deep half on Mike, releases it to apply a strong chop into the thoracic area of Mike Graham. And I'll tell you right now, Mike might be gasping for a lot of breath and oxygen.
Well, looks like he has Mike Graham right in the corner. Mike Graham is down. Looks like Mike Graham's in a lot of trouble right now. Now, Ric Flair is saying, oh, you want to be a champion, trying to humiliate Mike, but it's not over yet. Mike Graham valiantly fighting back. Mike Graham, quite a competitor. It takes a lot to stop a man like Mike. Another hard right, another and another. Ric Flair being thrown into a big high backdrop. Ric Flair's in a lot of trouble right now.
And Mike Graham showing that streak of Graham heredity. Eddie Graham of the past, fight it to the end, and here, Mike Graham coming back and fighting against the world champion with Chris Andre and whips into the rope and backdrop. And now, God's just snap there, however, held off as the world champion held onto the rope and applied some chops himself. And Mike's coming back with them.
Okay, with the action going on, we're going to have to take a moment to cut away for a commercial break. Right after this commercial break, we'll be right back. If anything happens, just stay tuned. Okay, here we are back now. Nothing has really happened yet. It seems like there's a lot of action going on during this last 2 minutes. Mike Graham coming out on top.
And Ric Flair administering a deep pass. And he's trying to lift Mike up for a vertical display. However, there's a
block finally, and he put the world champion off balance and took Ric Flair over for the vertical supply himself. Almost a fly and a half. However, he came back with a flying elbow drop that missed the world champion. And both men are in an awful lot of physical disadvantage and trouble at the present time. Chop being applied by Ric Flair. Front face lock dropped into a deep half. Vertical suplex applied onto Mike Cram by Ric Flair. And the fall. Full fall of the mat and far leg pickup. However, it wasn't strong enough to put the pinning combination on.
Okay, there's Ric Flair and Mike Cram just fighting back. Just hammer and elbow right now. It's like Mike Graham's coming out on top, able to hammer Ric Flair back into the corner. The forehead of Ric Flair has been lacerated badly. A big knee into the pit of the stomach of Mike Graham. It's like going into a nice move on the part of Mike Graham. The referee goes down. Reverse roll up. The shoulders are pinned on Ric Flair. The referee's not there to count. That could have been a pinfall for Mike Graham.
We had him trapped in that known as the O'Connor roll up or saddle cradle for a good 6 seconds, buddy. And that should have been it.
Right atomic there. Knee drop right there. That's it. Look, Mike Graham's going for the figure four leg lock. Mike has the figure four leg lock on the world champion, Ric Flair. This could be it. Let's see how long Ric Flair can hold on. This could be the win, a victory for Mike Graham. Now, wait a minute. Here comes Jesse Barr's in the ring. Look at this. Mostly, look at this. Jesse Barr coming from nowhere, running out of the dressing room.
Never.
And his friend Ric Flair was going to lose his match.
Mike Graham had this match certainly won now. Buddy, and interference of Jesse Barr has swallowed the day for Mike Graham. And here comes the final. Coming in, but Jesse Barr applied some hard right forearms and hands to the head. Now it's a free fall between four wrestlers going down.
Bobby McDaniel's able to come back and fight back. Right now it's going to be a very close here. There's all four men just fighting back and forth. You hear the victory sounding drop from Wahoo McDaniel. Mike Graham just all over Jesse Barr. Jesse Barr wasn't even scheduled to be wrestling here today. Those big tomahawk cuts, you can hear them all the way across the room.
Graham trying to take some revenge out against Barr, who has spoiled the day of victory for him. And there is no love lost between Wahoo McDaniel and world champion Ric Flair. What a turmoil on Tornado's action. And Flair coming back in against Wahoo McDaniel, only to be greeted by the world famous chop of Wahoo McDaniel. And Graham leveling some hard weight into Barr, and both Barr and Flair lead the ring.
Well, Ric Flair and Jesse Barr failing out, taking another time. They'll come back in another day. Okay, stay tuned. We'll be right back. Well, we've had a lot of action here today. What with Mike Graham, to me, really did defeat Ric Flair. We have another match coming up in the ring. We're scheduled for another match with Brian Blair and Tony D'Amata. I don't know if we're going to have time for that match or not. There's been so much happening that we're running down on time very quickly. We're waiting for the participants to come to the ring. Coach, have you ever seen this much happening here?
That's an awful lot of excitement. And to see the world champion, evidently, and in front of millions of people. He was actually pinned there one time in that O'Connor roll-up. And then again, he suffered the figure four leg lock. I know he was defeated. However, only through the interference of Jesse Bulldog Barr was there. There it comes right now on your screen. There's the interference that caused Mike Graham the factor of having beaten the world heavyweight wrestling champion.
That's right. As far as I'm concerned, Mike Graham has this Jesse Barr defeated. Now, Mike Graham and Chief Wahoo McDaniel have joined me here at the desk. Mike,
you know, it's a shame when a man such as myself gets such intimidated. Everyone must be afraid of me to be so intimidated because I said I want to have a title match. The Freebirds jump on me and go screaming and yelling. Ric Flair, the world champion, says he won't wrestle me. But then when he gets tipped on the spot, he will wrestle and has his man waiting to keep from being embarrassed. Wahoo, I can't help you enough for coming out like you did. And you know, I know you're after Flair. I'm after the world title. And I hope the day never comes. You've got more title shots than I will ever have. I hope the day never comes that I have to wrestle you for that world title. But I want the world title. I don't care who owns it. That's a very simple wish. For the Graham family, I want to win that world title.
I'll guarantee you one thing, Mike. I don't mind coming helping you. You know we've been friends for years. But Flair, you know, everybody thinks he's a fair-haired boy because he's pretty and he's got money and he's got women. Yeah, well, I'm going to tell you something, Flair, and you know it as well as anybody. You're a great champion, and I'm not taking anything away from it. But some of the ways you win your matches, brother, you should not be able to sleep at night. Just like today. You and Jesse Barr are friends. If it hadn't been for Jesse Barr, who knows? This man right here might be the man I've been buying his contract. I'd be buying Mike Graham's contract. Because I know, and you know deep down your heart, when you first started wrestling, I helped you every way I could. Then when you became the champion, I walked down the aisle with you, and I've walked down the aisle against you. And I'm not taking anything away from you because you're a great wrestler. But when he became the world champion, Mike, believe me, he forgot about the Indian. He forgot about the people who helped him get where he was. Well, I'm going to tell you, Flair, I've got one goal in mind. I don't have a lot of time like Mike Graham does. And I know he deserves a chance as much as anybody. But my time has come. I've got you backed up to the wall. Somewhere, sometime, someplace. Soon. Flair, because your voice is starting to squeak, I'm going to corner you, and I'm going to become the world champion.
Well, it's like we're running out of time. Thank you very much, Wahoo and Mike Graham. We'll see you next week.